So good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody, because we are maybe in different jet lags. It's important to again warmly thank Brinthef for this talk, for this invitation. So my presentation aims to challenge a worldview claiming that the figure of the missionary has disappeared from the sociological, economic, and even geopolitical landscape. And I therefore welcome the initiative of Brinthef project, which contrasts with a blind or neglectful reading of the religious fact and is therefore as close as possible to the ongoing dynamics. At the second international UCAT or Youth Catechism Congress held in the Philippines from 7 to 10 November 2019, the Apostolic Nuncio of Italian origin from the Holy See, Archbishop Gabriel Cassia, addressed Catholic youth with the following words in this slide. You are not only on mission, you are a mission. This speech was actually part of the preparation for the celebration of the 500th anniversary of the advent of Christianity in the Philippines. But it goes beyond the Philippine context. This speech actually reflects a deep reformulation of the Catholic missionary movement, which is also in competition with many other missionary groups in the world, not only Catholic, but also evangelical, Muslim, Buddhist, new religious movement, and so forth. There are many challenges in questioning missionary flows and logic in the Southeast Asian context, starting with the phenomenon of religious conversion, which is the major objective of these missionary initiatives. The other challenge relates to the circulatory dimension of these missionary activities, something that affects both the content of discourse and practice, the organization of communities, and the methodology to be used by the researcher. More than merely a galaxy of disparate elements or a linear and definitive historical process, this sociological and interactive network of missions invite researchers to examine a complex, multifaceted, and intertwined circulation of people, goods, and ideas. What historian Prasenjit Duara has identified as a circulatory global resource. With this expression, he named, I quote, a series of ideas, practices, and texts that enter societies or local as one kind of thing and emerge from it, considerably transformed to travel elsewhere, even as it refers back, often narratively, to the initiating moment. End of quote. In the course of this presentation, I will not focus on the impact of missionary action in terms of security, conversion statistics, state regulation, and local acculturation, or the hybridization of Panteons, but rather on the specificity of these missionary institutions and movement in, through, and from the Southeast Asia area. Of course, these vibrant situations need to be placed in the context of a worldwide phenomenon of religious mobility, so-called globalization of the religions, transnationalization of the religions, etc. The contemporary missionary scape reflects both a sense of continuity with earlier missionary tradition. For instance, the Western Catholic missionary congregation still send missionaries to Southeast Asia, but also and above all, on a sense of discontinuity with the past. In the first part, special attention will be paid to the humanitarian discourse and the new type of operational instrument, namely the faith-based NGOs, through which a large number of missionary programs operate towards Southeast Asia today. However, this part of the world cannot be reduced to a pure passive destination for cohorts of Western missionaries, since contemporary religious dynamics have been experiencing a plurality of intra or inter-Asian missionary networks. So the second part of my paper will focus on these dynamics, considering our ability and opportunity as researcher to formulate and give sense to them. If Southeast Asia is an ancient land of Christian mission, Catholic, apostolic, and Roman conception has prevailed among the missionaries at the end of the 19th and the beginning of the 12th century. In particular, they have intruded into the educational and local charity work during colonial times. Despite repeated phases of repression, Catholic communities today are composed of several missionary congregations, Jesuit, Franciscan, and Dominican historically, then Benedictine, Redemptorist, etc. However, a century later, and with colonial time behind us, the Christian landscape and the composition of its missionary forces have definitely changed. On the one hand, Catholic communities have gained more autonomy locally, and they require less the financial assistance or the supervision of catechism or learning Bible session from Western missionaries than a pastoral reinforcement and regulation of the communities. The Vatican is indeed been redoubling its efforts with special assembly organized during the 1998 Synod of Bishops, for instance, but also organizing international conferences, appointment of Asian cardinals, etc., to preserve the uniqueness or integrity of Catholic doctrine vis-a-vis the challenges caused by multiple theological interpretation and phenomena of inculturation that arose in the earlier missionary context. Moreover, the recomposition of the ecclesial field has been complicated by the voices raised by Asian and also African clergy, which is filling the voids of European parishes and is reconsidering, sometimes contesting, its long-standing marginal status within the church and is resolute to place itself at the heart of Catholicity. On the other hand, Southeast Asia has also been reached by the dominant currents of Pietist evangelicalism, Methodism, Baptism, Adventism, as well as by new charismatic expressions, thus reinforcing existing initiatives that have emerged from the 1950s onwards, particularly in the Americas and Africa. In terms of Pentecostalism and charismatic churches, Singapore, Hong Kong, Taiwan, PRC, Indonesia, Malaysia, and the Philippines are among the fastest growing in the world. For instance, between 1970 and 2000, the number of believers in Asia jumped from 10 to 135 million. It is worth mentioning the wide range of diversity found within what is called Protestantism and or evangelicalism, as well as the remarkable degree of autonomy of Southeast Asian churches from their mother church, whether they are based in the United States, Europe, or the Philippines, Hong Kong, Singapore, and South Korea, to name a few. Actually, as soon as an evangelical community can afford to be self-financing, it can establish itself as an autonomous church with no other links than administrative or denominational ones with other churches of the same denomination. According to the same organizational logic, many associations of so-called house church have first launched their own denomination with the consequence that they are not affiliated to any national or transnational church association and that they are founded only by the faithful of their parish. This evangelical mushrooming has resulted in a very competitive environment for groups and actors. Christianity, in both its Catholic and Protestant versions, has now been penetrating Southeast Asian, urban and rural societies, as well as the pioneer front lines and the ethnic margins areas of states. Henceforth, evangelical vitality in Southeast Asia is a clear fact. And I've published a book on that with Pascal Bourdeau in 2016, it's a limited volume on new Christian evangelical in Southeast Asia, which is a continuity of an article of Charles Keyes in 1996. To such an extent that since the 1990s, this new Christianization of the South, which has increasingly been carried out by missionaries from the South themselves, has been modelized by Louis Bush. Louis Bush is a Singapore-based Argentinian Pentecostal missiologist who is graduated in economics from the University of North Carolina. With his wife, he coined the concept of the so-called 1040 window. This is a reference to the latitudes of a space that stretch from West Africa to Japan, passing through Southeast Asia, which should be evangelized, as you say, as a matter of priority on the principle that it is a place where 2/3 of the world's population is to be found, and that is as among it the poorest of the poor. This is his motto. Louis Bush has also popularized the term 414 window, which is a child evangelism movement term originally coined by Brian Myers from World Vision NGO. The missionary target focus here on children between the age of 4 and 14 years old, with the objective to free them up from abuse and depression, economic and social poverty, and then to build up a youth generation able to change the world based on the teaching of the Bible. This movement echoes, as you can see, the youth catechism run by Catholic in my first slide. This geo-faith model is consistent with the spiritual wars to which many evangelical groups have been committed to since the end of the 19th century, and which have regularly given rise to the collective prayers, praying through the window, and mutual aid initiative, AD 2000 and Beyond Movement, etc., calling for deliverance of or war against satanic powers in the world, proselytizing, Bible translation, emotional invocation of the Holy Spirit, and finally conversion work have very often been concentrated in these geo-faith targets area since the 1990s. A series of local economic and social factors have in some way made local communities particularly receptive to Christian missiology and the proposed model of social reorganization. Indeed, many evangelical missionary programs have been taking up the theology of prosperity, which can be understood as an evangelical rhetoric claiming that material, social, professional, and family success should be interpreted as a sign of divine benevolence, and such success will then confirm the election and later the salvation of the believer. This discourse of conversion widespread in countries that have been experiencing a period of economic takeoff, like Cambodia, Laos, Burma, also economic transition, like Vietnam, Timor-Leste, economic growth, Philippines, Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, or even economic prosperity like Singapore. In this socio-economic and theological context, a transnational partnership between international churches and local Christian non-governmental organizations, NGOs, has repeatedly occurred, becoming what Kilby called in 2012 an epistemological tectonic shift. In this case, faith-based NGOs supply the international churches with powerful channels of evangelization in urban and rural areas under the guise of combating social ills, community violence, and more generally, situation of humanitarian crisis and individual vulnerability. This mechanism of influence through and around enclaves of subsidiarity, as the term coined by Dickoff and Portier, is filling in the gaps left by states, and it was pioneered in the 19th century by Catholic organizations. You can remember the so-called conferences or volunteer groups of Saint Vincent de Paul, but also pioneering by Protestant organizations like Salvation Army. Now, it is exercising its educational and social levers on a globalized and globalizing scale. The elective affinity between the religious, the aid sector, and donation network is not unique to Southeast Asia, but it corresponds to an evolution in the governance and mode of communication of religious institutions at a broader scale. Missionaries from different religions have chosen to focus on charitable activities in order to raise awareness in population with a doctrinal and ritualistic approach, but also, and this is more pragmatic dimension, but also to circumvent local legislation, which tends to be restrictive towards foreign religions or proselytism. And that with the objective for this missionary of obtaining a long-term visa. Indeed, proselytizing and sometimes religious freedom are not systematically guaranteed in the political and legislative frameworks of many regimes in ASEAN countries. Both the practice and the very idea of religious proselytizing remain, if not criticized, at least largely restricted and monitored throughout the region. This is evidenced by the numerous bureaucratic obstacles for registering places of worship of religion, like in Indonesia and Vietnam, or even we can see societal pressure when Buddhism, like in Myanmar, Thailand, and Cambodia, or Islam, Brunei, in Malaysia, are established as state religion. Door-to-door proselytizing and the distribution of religious tracts in public space are clearly prohibited in many countries, like in Brunei, Cambodia, Singapore, Vietnam. A repressive and even punitive policy against religious groups is periodically justified on the basis of enforcing public security, like in Philippines, Vietnam. A legal system inspired by Quranic law or Sharia, with the officialization of hudud or corporal punishment in Brunei, but also allegation of blasphemy in Indonesia or apostasy in Malaysia, is clearly dissuasive against foreign proselytism. In this kind of minefield against mission, if you can say, few missionaries dare to confront states' regulatory constraints, most of them opting instead for indirect penetration via the transnational network of faith-based NGOs. According to Kilby, the place and role of humanitarian aid would become unavoidable in shaping the global political and economic order, as well as, I would argue, the religious order. This coverage of faith-based NGOs, by my approach, owes a considerable debt to my discussion with Philip Fontaine and Michael Finner, and their very stimulating studies that I list here in my slide. I will pick up out just a few examples below. Many faith-based NGOs have been able to establish a lasting presence in Southeast Asia, a region that is conducive to humanitarian action for a series of reasons. I will only mention Islamic Relief Worldwide, Muslim Aid, Buddhist Global Relief, Shanti Volunteer Association, Caritas, of course, etc., etc. So you have the list. And which can be found in the work already cited of Michael Finner and Patrick Daly and Philip Fontaine. I will focus today on two evangelical organizations which have been developing proactive modes of strategies of penetration, setting up human development project, to quote Finner and Fontaine, which have been often replicated by the missionaries of other NGOs. The leading example of such initiatives initiated by religious groups to capitalize on the legislative channel and humanitarian discourse is the Protestant, Evangelical and Pentecostal mega NGO World Vision International, with annual income of $2.7 billion, with 2.6 million donors and 44,000 employees operating in nearly 100 countries in 2018, World Vision International stands as the largest NGO in the world today in terms of income and outreach. The organization was founded in 2015 by the American Baptist theologian Robert Pierce, and its members explicitly inscribe their action within a spirit of crusade and witness of their experience of the incarnational love of Jesus Christ, I quote. Nearly $479 million was spent by World Vision in the Asia Pacific region in 2018 in the following areas: access to water, education, health, food, economic development, child protection. World Vision assumes the Protestant faith of its members and claims that this is adapted to the secularized norms of the International Humanitarian Code of the Red Cross and Sphere Project, which base its principle on the neutrality and independence of humanitarian actors, regardless of ethnicity, gender, or religion. World Vision International has been coordinating programs in each of the ASEAN countries, with the interesting exception of Brunei, where foreign NGOs are banned and the state is exclusive in all sectors of society. World Vision International has been operating in the aftermath of Mangkhut typhoon in the Philippines in 2018, the tsunami in Sulawesi, for instance. The Singaporean evangelical communities are found also in World Vision International structure, a platform to spread not only the Christian message and its prosperity theology, but also the economic model of the city-state, especially since World Vision involvement in the Boat People refugee relief in 1978-79. In 2018, World Vision Singapore raised nearly 18 million Singapore dollars to support projects in ASEAN countries, as well as in Africa and the Middle East, and responded to local emergencies for more than 2 million people, including 700,000 children. Not as easily identifiable as World Vision International, the presence of the Summer Institute of Linguistics, SIL, demonstrates the contemporary duplication in Southeast Asia of a resolutely, what I can say, sinuous, subtle, and flexible mode of evangelical conversion previously applied to the educational field in Central and South America. SIL does not really fit prescript expectation and patterns for other organizations doing cross-cultural work. Here you can find a quote from Kenneth Gregerson and Kenneth Smith, who wrote down the report on SIL in Vietnam and its legacy in Southeast Asia, 1978, a report that I have published in my 2016 book on Christian evangelicalism. And in this report, Gregerson and Smith asked the question about SIL missionaries, SIL volunteers, etc. Are they missionaries? Are they linguists? Are they working with the church, or are they secular, working with the government or with academic intelligentsia? Are they practical humanitarians, or do they have an even higher message? The answer to this question is yes. The SIL has been operating in the United States from 1942 onwards and developed first in the Philippines, 1953, and then in Vietnam, from where the Institute has spread. This double experience in the Philippines and Vietnam was then used as a springboard to evangelize other countries as soon as the political context allowed it, like in Cambodia, Thailand, Indonesia, Malaysia, in the Borneo side, but also India, Nepal, etc. The pedagogy of conversion, as I call it in my article 2016, proposed by SIL missionaries, mainly from the United States, but also from Anglican and Lutheran countries, so United Kingdom and Scandinavian countries, promotes literacy in a mother tongue even before developing knowledge of the national language of the country. This is intended to allow educator slash language slash missionaries to have direct access to practical knowledge in the areas of sanitation, healthcare, education, trade, through the study of the Bible. A key promoter of this Protestant missionary activity in Southeast Asia has been the Far East Broadcasting Company. Established in 1948 in Manila, it has broadcast in over 40 different languages. The Southeast Asia Radio Voice Service did the same, again, from the Philippines. The SIL, interestingly, has integrated training programs around the world with special consultative status with UNESCO, for example. Its partnership with local educational institutions, in partnership with local educational institutions, SIL delivers training for what they call applied linguistic fieldwork. Among the subjects covered by our courses in phonetics, phonology, syntax, discourse, cultural anthropology, linguistic fieldwork method, sociolinguistic, language program planning, and translation. The work of this evangelical institute is consistently at the crossroad of evangelism, social work, education, and academic research. While its members have never made a secret of their primary goal of translating the Bible into all existing languages, they have also produced hitherto unavailable ethnographic, sociological, and linguistic studies by means of participative observation and lexical survey methods. This characteristic has often made it embarrassing for the researcher to use and even question the data provided by SIL, like maps, linguistic, economic, political, and ethnographic statistics, language dictionary, and methods. A significant level of evangelical development was achieved in the late 1990s and early 2000s through the systematic centralization of ethnographic, linguistic, and cartographic data of the SIL by means of the Joshua Project. This platform is promoted by numerous evangelical centers and networks, and it explicitly incorporates the progressive and visual conceptual framework of the 1040 window. Such a relationship between the religious and the humanitarian actions make it difficult to decipher as it reveals the shadow of a missionary behind activities that usually do not seem to be so at the first glance. But this theme of religious mobility also implies questioning some new deterritorialized identity spaces and the displacement of the religious imagination. The above cases illustrate a shift from the original Catholic missionary paradigm in Southeast Asia to a multi-faith missionary paradigm. Within this religious mobility, a spectrum of missionary strategies is significantly emanating from Asia. The Chinese and South Korean models are among the most elaborate ones in terms of this orientalization of the evangelical churches, but also in terms of their genuine strategy of global expansion. South Korean evangelical and Pentecostal missionaries, for example, have been developing a rhetoric that stresses the similarity of South Korea's recent political and economic trajectory with most of Southeast Asian countries, namely the traumatic sequences of colonization, civil war, and the conditions of poverty that prevail in many of them. South Korea's ongoing economic expansion and cultural prominence could not justify better, pastors and missionaries argued. The prosperity theology they employ in their proselytizing, while posturing themselves and their church, and that is also interesting, as national champions of the South Korean government effort in recent years to promote nation branding outside South Korean borders. Such a discourse of intra-Asian evangelicalism puts forward the trans-historical and transnational character of these new Asian mother churches, or more broadly, the pan-Asian patterns of contemporary South Korean Protestant missiology. It also echoes other missionary cases in the region, and not only Christian ones. Among Chinese Christian communities in the PRC and overseas, the missionary model of the 1040 window, mainland China lies actually between 10 and 40 north latitude, has gradually been reappropriated. In 1996, a missionary program called Back to Jerusalem was launched to structure underground house church, gathering of believers in their home, with the objective of sending 100,000 missionaries in the coming years to the land located to the west of China, towards Jerusalem, along the ancient Silk Road, if necessary, risking their lives. Liu Zhengying, alias Brother Yun, is credited with revitalizing this missiology of martyrdom, which actually goes back to the origins of Chinese evangelization. After finding political asylum in Germany in 2001 and with fundraising support from American evangelicals, he has since been traveling through Chinese overseas Christian networks to inspire missionary departure to Muslim or Hindu lands. In Southeast Asia, his concept of the missionary martyr has been most widely accepted among Chinese community in Singapore, Malaysia, and you saw in the previous slide, so some video that I found it in a website in Malaysia and Singapore website, and also in the Philippines, based on decades of evangelical training in local Chinese language seminaries and Bible schools. Let's move now to the missionary contours of Reform Buddhism. And I thank in advance my friend David Palmer for the copyright, because I post the cover of his book. So at the end of the 19th and especially at the beginning of the 20th century, initiatives have emerged within the Buddhist clergy to renew the image and practice of Buddhism and equip it with the appropriate resources to engage with Western modernity. Among the multitude of personalities and projects that this movement has known, the Chinese monk Taisu, in retrospect, incarnates this reformist impulse. This impetus to spread the doctrine of the Buddha or the Enlightened outside the monastic spheres go beyond the republican framework in which it was born, and has been extending to the many manifestations of Buddhist charitable activities and propagation of a humanistic Buddhism, to quote Vasant Gosayat and David Palmer. Taisu's directives aimed in particular at raising the training of bonzes, of monks, limiting them, but at the same time increasing the number of Buddhist laymen to radiate the doctrine of the Enlightened, the Buddha, outside the monastic sphere, and making an effort to engage and adapt to the contemporary cultural and scientific context throughout the translation and publication of religious texts. This revival process was finally intended to provide Buddhism with an organization more consistent with contemporary issues, putting it in a position to stand up to its main competitor, the Christian Church, which had become the new paradigm of religion in China. Like here again, I quote Vincent Gossel and David Palmer, and some specific page of their book. In the late 1990s, as Taiwan became the global center of Reform Buddhism and the source of a reformist momentum affiliated with the Tai Su guidelines, many Taiwanese religious organizations took on Southeast Asian Chinese communities as their missionary targets. In some cases, they have attempted to rally together non-Chinese population to their cause, which is a religious, political, and social cause. The new transnational social space developed by Tzu Chi are meaningful in this regard. Founded in 1966 by the female Venerable Cheng Yan, the Tzu Chi Buddhist Relief and Compassion Foundation took progressively the form of a faith-based NGO. Its charitable works, medical assistance, disaster relief, and education are based on an eschatological Buddhist concept of accumulating merit while appropriating the holistic model of evangelical megachurches to its Buddhist mega pagoda. Originally, filling the gap left by the state in the poor regions of northeastern Taiwan, Tzu Chi humanitarian work is carried out by Buddhist lay volunteers and has progressively developed a large network around the world. The organization claims today to have the support of several million people, with some volunteers into some 35 national sections, with significant establishment in Indonesia, Malaysia, and even in mainland China. We've already in the mid-90s an annual income of 150 million US dollar and assets in the form of hospitals and properties worth 9 billion, quote Vincent Gossel and David Palmer. Tzu Chi strengthened its international influence in 2010 by becoming one of the 8 NGOs with special consultative status among the United Nations Economic and Social Council. Because of its mode of penetration, largely among local elites of Chinese origin and mainly urban elites, combined with a practice of transnational networking and holistic functioning, the Tzu Chi NGO was sometimes analyzed in terms of an original Buddhist cosmopolitanism, a quote of one, which serves as a model for other Taiwanese and East Asian Buddhist organizations, such as Fo Guangshan, the Buddha's Mountain of Light, for instance, which has a strong presence in Malaysia, Singapore, the Philippines, etc. The Vietnamese Zen monk Thich Nhat Hanh, born in 1926 in central Vietnam, is a worldwide icon of Buddhist reformism, who enjoys a significant membership and disciples, and also inscribed his propagation in the Tai Su legacy. Established in Saigon in 1966, his order of interbeing is a community of monastic and lay practitioners based in southwestern France at Village de Prunier or Plume Village. The socially committed ethic of this monk, most of his life in political asylum out of Vietnam, has been revealed through his poetic, metaphorical, and pragmatic transmission of Buddhist texts and their translation, and through their systematic comparison with Christian and scientific conception of the world. He rejected the idea of restricting Buddhist doctrine and ritual to a traditional funerary practice and to the search of post-mortem salvation, and instead inscribed them in the most materialistic and modern daily life, like to practice meditation while walking in the street, watching television, driving a car, etc. He saw this as a way of bringing compassion and full awareness, or right mindfulness, into every action, and ultimately of facilitating karmic liberation, whatever the religion of the practitioner. He returned to Vietnam in 2005, 2007, and 2008, and received a lot of media coverage, especially as he ordained monks without the approval of the local Sangha or official Buddhist religious authority. Irritating the officials by the repeated calls for religious freedom by some members of the order, the master Thich Nhat Hanh and 400 disciples were expelled out of Vietnam by the government in 2009, giving reason actually to the grumbling of Vietnamese Buddhist officials who were locally concerned about the popularity of this, what they consider as a heterodox Buddhism, with its suspicious but above all competitive international levels of action. The order of interbeing has given rise to numerous initiatives in Asia, such as the opening of lay centers in Beijing, Indonesia, Malaysia, the Philippines, Singapore, the creation of the Asian Institute of Applied Buddhism Studies and Practice in Hong Kong, the opening of a plum village in Thailand, and even a monastery in Victoria, Australia. Like many other charismatic figures, like Vivekananda, Tagore, Krishnamurti, Suzuki, etc., Thich Nhat Hanh conveys a Western discourse on Asian spiritualities, interweaving teaching from Zen Buddhism, yoga chara, the practice of yoga, and psychology. If his teaching has been able to influence therapists, politicians, educators, and environmental activists who are not Buddhists in the first place, for instance, he gave training in a Google office, we can see the missionary mode of operation of his Vietnamese order, which from its headquarters in France reformulates existential projects through a Buddhist perspective, forge new sociabilities around the master and meditative temporalities, operates a new normalization and moralization of the individual and of the social bond over a more or less long period of time, with ordination or short-term, middle-term internship retirements of lay people. The case of Thich Nhat Hanh thus gives reason to John Borup when he underlines the capacity of contemporary Vietnamese Zen to reverse Orientalism, as he said, contributing not only to the Buddhist and Vietnamese reinterpretation of the West and of Christianity in particular, but also to the Western reinterpretation of Buddhism and in a circulatory movement of a pastoral and missionary nature to an Asian reappropriation of its Buddhism reform in the West. Today, the third religion in Vietnam, after Buddhism and Catholicism, with between 2 million and 4 million adepts, Caudaism appeared in 1926 under French colonial rules and also present itself from its origin in Cochin China and Annam as a renewed Buddhism. It aims to revitalize the worship and values of three teachings, Buddhism, Confucianism, and Taoism, through spirit mediumship practice, while integrating Western Catholic and Spiritist figures into it, its pantheon, like Victor Hugo, Joan of Arc, etc. Taoism, however, belongs to the tradition of redemptive societies, which is different from the tradition that of Thich Nhat Hanh. Redemptive societies, in short, inherited the Chinese tradition of salvationist sectarianism, but tried to articulate a vision of universal spiritual civilization, often employing modern forms of organization, charity, disaster relief, and education. in 1927, a foreign mission of Taoism was founded in the Kingdom of Cambodia by the Holy See of Tainan, based in southern Cochin China, which began to convert Vietnamese, Chinese, and Khmer population to Taoism. This Vietnamese religion is now found in Australia, France, and the United States, not as a result of a missiological strategy centralized in Vietnam, but as a faith transported by successive waves of migration following the Vietnamese government in 1975-1978 punitive repression against people like many Taoists actually, who had fought against communism for decades. The Taoist Overseas Missionary Association had the largest number of overseas followers, estimated at around 15,000 people, and was influential in Western countries until 2010 and its dissolution. Its leadership had developed an original strategy to renegotiate its role in contemporary Vietnamese society by establishing this overseas Kaodai community as an essential partner in the relations between the government and the Socialist Republic of Vietnam and the historical Holy See of Tainan. Kaodai overseas missionary actively worked and successfully to bring back to Vietnam in November-December 2006 the body, the mummified body of the chief of the medium, Tham Kontak, was being held in Phnom Penh since his death in 1959. So to conclude, let's try to wrap up and to see that, and to say also that to map the ongoing religious mutation and issues in Southeast Asia, it's certainly necessary to maintain an open and dynamic definition of this space. This space is being targeted by proselytizing networks of all kinds, very often justifying their contemporary action by humanitarian ideals or by identity-based discourses carried by believers from the Chinese diaspora or those returning from exile. The vitality of missions is also not inconsistent with certain phenomena of secularization. The methodological challenge for the researcher consists in not only regarding Southeast Asia as the target of a solely extra-Asian religious proselytism, missionary, for instance, missionary ideologies coming from outside the region, but also in considering Asian missiology ideology within the region and the one from the region, keeping a critical and historical distance with Orientalist or ethnocentric stereotypes, we were able to identify how the Southeast Asian region has recently produced missionary groups or strategies that have reformed the meaning transmitted by the great, so-called great religions, monotheist great religions, that it had hosted, giving rise to multifold missionary scenario. So we have seen cases of Pan-Asian or Northeast Southeast map mission from South Korea, for instance, Suchi, Orientalist or East-West mission, South Korean, Suchi, Thich Nhat Hanh, Taoism, and even reverse Orientalist or East-West-East with a circulatory system mission with Thich Nhat Hanh, and also reverse or East-Middle East mission, such as the Back to Jerusalem movement. As I have already studied with David Palmer with a paper on Taoism that you mentioned at the beginning of this talk, it is perhaps in the realm of religion and spirituality that we can find the most concerted efforts of Asians to speak back to Europeans in their own idioms, with the intent not only to express indigenous beliefs and ideas in European languages, but also to construct, to build up an alternative an alternative oriental vision of spiritual civilization, universal and potentially superior to that of the West. One of the questions, one of the many questions I have actually when I was preparing this talk, are the following. Can we find a concept to describe intra-Asian evangelization? And about this intra-Asian mission, is there anything special about them that will differentiate them from Western mission in Asia? Do this mission conceal colonial intention, for instance? Are these missions a continuation of ancient regional bilateral relationship between the local country in Asia? Looking at the literature on missions, we see little effort actually to conceptualize this inter-Asian missions methodologically. From debates among evangelical mission circles in the 1970s and 90s on missionary work, to and by third world churches, the term reverse mission or return mission emerged as a very fashionable topic in theology and the social sciences. Actually, at the beginning, a month ago, I have a project to use this term, but after the reading of different books about an article about reverse mission, which is sometimes used to describe this phenomenon studied during this presentation, we can see existing definition of reverse mission are very approximate and very well, that was very well underlined by Maurier Genoux in a recent paper. Because reverse mission encompasses a high diversity actually of missionary scenario. At the same term, run several definitions at the same time, adding to the confusion to the phenomena. So you understand that with all these questions that my presentation today, I'd like to call for more research on this new kind of mission and missionaries with the methodological guideline to not just talk about multi-sided fieldwork to understand this phenomenon, but also to keep in mind the very secularity of the discourse and fact observed. Inspired by Talal Asad's understanding of religion as a trans-historical, trans-cultural phenomenon, one should not fossilize the term mission and missionaries in one place and time. Rather, we need to analyze them in terms of historical shift that bring them into a continuous discontinuity and as the historical and geographical product of discursive process. Thank you very much.